Yo, this is Deontay the Bronze Bummer Wilder, heavyweight champion of the world, and you're watching Real Fans Real Talk.
Face facts, what up?
RealFansRealTalk.com, where Arthur Diamond's Trip Young and intern Tom. For the white and black fans, Asia to Manhattan, I get all my facts from my bro Mark the Stats Man. If you're not tuned in, I recommend the CAT scan. And if your brain checks out, then you deserve a backhand. Sports, gossip, all the hot topics. RealFansRealTalk.com got it. They got the hottest bloggers.
Is Jeremy Lin hurt?
Well, log onto the site and you can hear it from them first. I'm talking about the latest. I'm talking about the greatest. Go check out the archives. Even tell a neighbor. Tell them Bobby sent ya. From spring to winter, tuning in should be the only thing on your agenda. Certified cosign. You know what I'm about, son. RealFansRealTalk.com. I'm out. One. Real fans, real talk. Real fans, real talk. Real fans, real talk.com. Real fans, real talk.com. Real fans, real talk. Real fans, real talk. Real fans, real talk.com. Real fans, real talk.com.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to another live episode of Real Fans, Real Talk. I'm Mark the Statman Skevich. Great time in sports. The Super Bowl is upon us. A lot going on in the world of sports. Trip Young has some things to say today, too, as well. And I'm very excited for this episode of Real Fans, Real Talk. But before we get into everything, let me introduce my co-host, the one and only Trip Young. What's going on, Trip?
What's going on, Stat Man? It's definitely been a great week. And I will say, I'm gonna say this real quick and just get this out the way.
In the beginning of the program?
Right, in the beginning of the program.
Oh, okay.
Start the program. All right. This. The New York Knicks, as bad as they are, haven't won a championship in over 40 years.
What's with the fine
years.
Print here? Hold on. I thought you got the say.
You know, even though, you know, New York is supposed to be the mecca of basketball.
It is.
They are still, well, you couldn't tell by the way the Knicks play, but they are still the greatest franchise in basketball and
in basketball history,
solely based on the fact that they're worth over $3 billion. So there you go. It's all about the money. It's all about the check. But more importantly, shout out to Wifey for Lifey, my baby boo thing, Serena, because she has been kicking butt and taking names. I've been having to stay up all night and all morning to watch these matches. But she smoked Sharapova. She smoked Radwanska, Kapinska, Kapowski, Kelly Kapowski, whatever you want to call it. She is running through the competition at the Australian Open, and she has solidified her spot in the finals. And that's going to be going down on Saturday night. She's going to finish what she started because we chasing that record, baby. All-time Grand Slam champion, my wifey for lifey, Serena Williams.
You transitioned from a very bold statement there, Trip Young. I mean, the Knicks, the greatest NBA franchise in history? That's a very bold statement.
I said they're making the most money. So, you know, anybody that's making the most money, I got to give them that. It's all about the money because it definitely is not about the championships because they don't come to New York very often. Well, in basketball anyway. Baseball, we get them quite often, but not basketball.
Well, Kevin Durant might be interested in the franchise level. We'll get into all the Knicks stuff a little bit later on, but I do... you know, there was some sad news in the sports world, especially hitting home with me personally. My hockey coach from high school, a lot more than just the coach, Richard Meyer, he passed away over this past weekend. Had to go to the wake yesterday. And, you know, like I said, he's a lot more than just a hockey coach. He's the type, I was honored that Joe Micheletti, the announcer for the New York Rangers, gave him announced about his passing. And I'll talk a little bit more about the coach, but this past weekend against the Ottawa Senators, him and Sam Rosen discussed the passing of my coach, Richard Meyer. Let's play that clip real quick, and then I'll get into some more of the details of this great man.
Sadness that we report today the passing of one of the great amateur hockey coaches in New York. He coached the New York Stars for many, many years. Richie Meyer, coached Brian Mullen. He coached Pat Bowler, who's an assistant coach in the Rangers American Hockey League team. Damian Echevarrieta, who's with the National Hockey League. And he was a father figure to a lot of these players, and he passed away today, sadly.
Condolences.
He was one of these guys, Sam, that the kid didn't have a ride to practice. He'd pick the kid up, go over there, get him, bring him to practice, bring him home afterwards.
So many unsung heroes like that, Joe.
Served as a mentor for these kids for years and years and years, and he passed away today. So it's a sad day for a lot of people that that knew Richie Meyer.
8:50.
Now,
great sadness that...
As he said, he used the words mentor, he used the words father figure. He talked about how he picked up some kids who didn't have a ride. And I was one of those kids, but it's pretty far out of his way for in some of these cases. He would pick the kid up, drop them off at practice, and then bring him home. I mean, when you're lugging a big hockey bag, you know, not have to take that on the bus, on the train, and he has a van full of kids that he's making stops. He worked full-time at the MTA. He coached a team, and he took us to Coney Island theme park. He actually had a road trip to Canada, which was one of the greatest life experiences I've had. A few members of the team, we went to stop at Duff's in Buffalo for Buffalo Wild Wings, like the best wings you could imagine. Went to Niagara Falls and all the activities there, the boat rides over there. Toronto for the Hockey Hall of Fame, Wayne Gretzky's restaurant, a lot of stuff, you know. We practiced at Rye Playland where the Rangers practice, and, you know, I touched Wayne Gretzky's helmet, and as a kid, you know, Wayne Gretzky was the best there was while he was playing for the Rangers, going there to Wayne Gretzky's locker and stuff. I mean, it was great how he went the extra mile for all these kids, and you could see, you know, by him being announced on the Rangers that he was loved by many, including myself. So this episode is dedicated to Richard Meyer, and thankful for everything he did for me and all the other lives that he touched. And we're just going to have a quick moment of silence, then we'll carry on with the sports news. All right, so we do have a lot to talk about. The sad part is, you know, out of the way. It is Super Bowl approaching us, but we did have the Pro Bowl announcements yesterday. Michael Irvin and Jerry Rice going at it in a fantasy style, picking the picks for the Pro Bowl.
And who got picked first?
Russell Wilson.
On the other team?
Eli Manning.
That's right.
I was going to get to that.
I was a little excited about that.
You know, and Eli Manning went, and, you know, because technically they weren't the first picks because there were some picks made before the broadcast, and Odell Beckham was one of the first picked. You know, I think they had three guys who were honorary captains as well who were helping them make the picks. Yeah. And Eli Manning said to Odell Beckham, well, next year you could have 100 catches, or you could have zero if you don't pick me. So, that, you know, the decision's yours, though.
Listen, but he put the choice in his hands, though.
Exactly.
And he's still winning with Eli, you know.
So he picked Eli Manning. Eli Manning able to play because Cam Newton is not playing because of the Super Bowl. So he was one of the last picks to make it to the Pro Bowl, one of the first selected in the fantasy draft style. I like the fantasy draft style, you know, as opposed to the traditional AFC, NFC. They brought it in recently. It makes it a little bit more fun. You have Odell Beckham Jr. and Jarvis Landry playing together. They were LSU teammates in college. Mm-hmm. They play in opposite conferences, Dolphins and Giants. So they'll be playing together as opposed to against each other. So that, you know, that's it's good that they don't have the NFC, AFC thing. The draft itself, I was watching it. It was a little bit, you know, like every time they made a pick within the first five picks, it's like, oh, you picked him, like trying to make it like an actual fantasy draft. Like, I mean, come on, like, really? Like, is it really hurting you that bad that he went and picked him? Like, he was your next pick or something? Like,
hey, listen,
it was kind of acted out a little bit, but it was still fun nonetheless.
They got to hype it up because the Pro Bowl, you know, there's nothing really in it, you know what I mean? So the fans aren't really into it. So at least I will say this kind of adds a little bit to the Pro Bowl, because it's not, like you said, not the same old traditional thing, and then you kind of really get to mix up the teams, so it's good. But I'm glad that Eli and Odell will get one more chance this season to showcase some of that magic.
Yeah, definitely. And I was kind of thinking, like, you pick Russell Wilson first on one side, in a traditional fantasy, if you know it's only head-to-head, why would you pick a quarterback as your next pick?
Yeah, exactly.
But at the same time, You got you know, multiple quarterbacks playing because they only play, you know, one, a little over one quarter each. So yeah. To pick Eli Manning was probably a good move. I got no complaints against it.
Yeah.
And if you got Odell Beckham, you want the guy that, you know, has the most chemistry. Richard Sherman will be on the other side, so we'll probably see a Richard Sherman and Odell Beckham Jr. matchup. So I think I'm going to watch the Pro Bowl this year. I usually say I don't watch it, and I usually don't watch it. Yeah. But it is, the second highest rated football game out there. So people watch it, even though they say they're not going to watch it. I mean, it might be on in the background while I'm doing something else.
Yeah, but
at the same time, I think I'm going to tune in this year.
Yeah, I'll check it out since Eli's is playing. I'm just definitely going to have to check it out and see what's going on in the Pro Bowl. So I like the draft pick.
Charles Woodson was picked last, and John Gruden was saying there's something wrong with you guys, but they said that they did it on purpose to save the best for last so they could talk more about him and 18 seasons. And it's not like a Kobe Bryant being selected to the Pro Bowl type of thing. He had 5 interceptions this year. Finally got his interception against Peyton Manning, which he never got before in his career. So great season for him. They're definitely not going out with a bang there. And it's going to be, obviously, his last NFL game is in the Pro Bowl. So it's definitely very fitting.
Yeah, great way to go out. I mean, barring winning the Super Bowl, but I'll definitely take ending off in the Pro Bowl when you get picked by your peers, you know. And he had a great career altogether anyway, but he definitely finished off strong this season. So I'm happy for him, and I am looking forward to seeing him in this game. I hope he does get a pick this in the Pro Bowl.
Yeah, definitely. All right, but we do have the real game coming up the following week, and that is the Super Bowl. And, I think it's going to be a lot better than some people think. You know, Peyton Manning and the Broncos going up against killer Cam Newton and the Panthers. I mean, a lot of people are worried that Peyton Manning's going to get blown out just like he did against Seattle. I mean, this year he has a far better defense than he did when he got to the Super Bowl a couple of years ago with Denver.
But he still is throwing those ducks.
He's managing the game a little bit, but he's not throwing that far, so there's not that many.
As long as he keeps it within 10 to 15 yards, I guess it'll be good.
I mean, he threw for 2 touchdowns in the last game, so what a lot of people aren't realizing is he was playing hurt this season. Like, you're talking about him not playing typical Peyton Manning, but he was playing hurt. It's not like it was just old age. Like, he was playing hurt in the games that he was playing bad, and he was just trying to, you know, play through the injury that obviously they decided the smart thing that, hey, let's take him out, let's let him heal and have him ready for the playoffs. Yeah. And he came back in the playoffs and he got the job done. But New England Patriots have a great offense. So I know Cam Newton is great and everything, but I think the Patriots have a more dynamic offense, more weapons than Cam Newton and the Panthers. They're more known for their defense. So it's going to be a defense wins championships game either way with either team that wins, because the Denver is number one and, Panthers defense is up there as well. And
who's more likely to get picked off, though?
I mean, that's going to be Peyton Manning. I mean, more likely you would figure it's going to be Peyton Manning. But Cam Newton's not going to have as much luxury. I think Von Miller of the Broncos is going to be applying that pressure. And
DeMarcus Ware as well.
Exactly. So he's not going to have his way like he did in previous matchups against Arizona.
I will admit, and I was actually talking about this with the fans right before I walked into the studio. I feel like the Panthers are going to win this game, and I do want to see Cam Newton dab in the end zone, but something is telling me that the Broncos might take this Super Bowl. I don't know why I'm getting that feeling in my gut, but something is just telling me that they might just get this game.
Yeah, I mean, I'm kind of thinking it's going to be the Broncos as well. I mean, I just think that it's going to be a close game.
Mm-hmm.
It's probably going to be around 20 points each. I'm a Cam Newton fan. I was in the middle of the season and all the way forward, I'm all for him winning the MVP. Earlier in the season, we asked, who would you rather have, Russell Wilson or Cam? You pick Russell Wilson. I pick Cam. And I think he's playing great, but I think, the Broncos defense and you know, Peyton Manning is still Peyton Manning. Yeah. And, you know, he managed to beat Tom Brady and the Patriots. And I think it's not that far-fetched that he comes across with the Super Bowl victory and leaves kind of like another Bronco, John Elway, left coming out on top. And that's a great way to go out. There's no talk from Peyton Manning about retiring after the season. Everyone thinks that he's going to be done, but he has so much as murmured saying this is going to be his last season. So this is all skepticism based on his performance this year. But I think if he wins the Super Bowl, he definitely doesn't come back. But if he gets blown out, which I don't think is going to happen did against Seattle, I don't think he's going to go out like that. He's going to play another season, and no matter how that season goes, he might retire on a future season. I don't think he leaves with a Super Bowl loss. So, but I think he will come out on top.
Yeah, if you win, you got to retire on top. Like there's no reason at all. You have enough money. He's still going to get them same endorsements. I love Peyton Manning and all the Papa John's ads and, you know, the DirecTV ads. So he's still going to get those endorsements. He doesn't need the check. There's no reason to come back. If he wins, you go out on top like Michael Strahan did it when the Giants won. So you got to go and just sit out. But lose... if he wants to come back, all right, give it one more try. But I don't think he's going to get completely dominated in the Super Bowl. So I think...
As a quarterback, to have multiple Super Bowl championships with different teams, that's an accomplishment in itself. So he's pretty much up there. And he'll tie his brother finally.
Yeah, exactly. That's really why he's staying around as long. He can't let
little brother got two. He only got one. Like, how is he? Little brother's probably still going to get more than two.
Exactly.
A lot to go, but we got a fan mail question. Cam Newton made some comments earlier this week saying, first of all, Joe from Bay Ridge wrote in. Cam Newton, what do you guys think of Cam Newton saying he's an African-American quarterback? And some people might not like that. And, you know, maybe because they can't compare him to anything that they've ever seen before.
Well, all right, here's the thing with that. I understand what he's saying because usually, I guess, the stereotypical for an African-American quarterback is they're great runners, the athletic quarterbacks, but they're not the best passers. And we saw that with Michael Vick, who was you couldn't do anything with Michael Vick, but he wasn't the most accurate of passers. You know, same thing we saw that with Russell Wilson early on, even though this year he had a phenomenal year, but great runner, not as accurate as say a Tom Brady or a Peyton or an Aaron Rodgers or any of those guys. But here you have Cam Newton who passes the ball very accurately, and he runs the ball like a running back or a fullback. So it's like, for me, it's like my dream quarterback in Madden. Like, I always had to get Michael Vick, and then, you know, I just had to keep working on him until his accuracy was up there as well. So that's kind of what you get with Cam Newton, and that is something that really hasn't been seen before because that's what it was. It was a lot of African-American
Warren
quarterbacks.
Moon was one of the most accurate quarterbacks, African-American or white.
Yeah.
He was a great, accurate quarterback. Doug Williams, obviously, Super Bowl champion. Mm-hmm. So it's not like he's probably at a higher level than some of them maybe. But I think, I don't know how accurate that statement is, but what do you think as far as Warren Moon?
I guess Warren Moon was pretty accurate. Is he a better runner than Cam Newton?
No.
That's what I'm saying. So it's kind of like, and that's
he was
where,
a better passer by far.
He's a better passer, and that's where it is. Because for the most part, it is like that where they're better runners and scrambling quarterbacks. But when it comes to the accuracy, even Michael Vick had a great arm, like he could throw the ball deep, but he wasn't that accurate of a quarterback by any means. And that didn't take away from the fact that he was still one of the best quarterbacks in his prime in the NFL. But with Cam Newton, he kind of, cancels that stereotype out that African-American quarterbacks can't throw and can't be accurate, plus still be one of the best running quarterbacks that's out there. And that's something that's different because now you have to have a spy on him because he can take off at any time. But you also have to have guys covered because he's very accurate. He can throw. So, you know, I guess I kind of I agree with what he's saying. I mean, I guess that is kind of scary, but that's kind of scary if it was anybody. Yeah, I mean, it's not exactly. Even just about him being African American, you know. But,
and to compare him to, like, why would you need anyone to compare him to the past? Like, what difference would that make about scaring?
It's
like,
just
we can't compare him to another one, so what, like, we're, like, I don't get it.
Any quarterback that could run like Cam Newton and could pass, you know, like one of the more accurate quarterbacks in the league, that would be scary to anybody. So
especially the opponents.
Yeah, exactly. But, I mean, do we often see, like, have we seen any Caucasian quarterbacks that can run like a Michael Vick, like a Newton or Russell Wilson? I mean, I guess the closest thing would maybe be Steve Young. But even with Steve Young, like, you know, Steve Young wasn't running the way, you know, the African-American quarterbacks are scrambling and running 60 yards down the field and doing things, or RG3 or, you know, one of those quarterbacks. So it's new, but like I said, I don't think it's not an African-American, it's just a quarterback thing. If you saw a quarterback that could pass like one of the elite passers and still run like an elite running quarterback, that's scary, because how can you really stop that?
No.
Because at least you know if he can run but he can't pass too accurately, all right, we can stack up the front, you know, keep a couple of spies on him. If he can pass, all right, we can play deep.
I mean, Aaron Rodgers is a running quarterback that's more accurate than Cam. He can't run as good as Cam, but he's still a running quarterback, too. He's not as good this year as Cam Newton, not at all, actually.
But to run for as many yards, though, at the same time, too. Like, you're not running – Aaron Rodgers is not running like Cam Newton or any of those guys. Now, he's more accurate than Cam Newton, but as far as running, he does run well, but not on that level. So we're talking about an elite level.
So
one
yeah, we can't compare him to anybody, I guess. So
he's his own. Now we got to start comparing.
To be scared about it, I don't know.
Yeah, we got to start comparing other quarterbacks to Cam Newton as they become more accurate.
I want to address the haters out here. You know, with Cam Newton, he's obviously got the. I like the line. Too bad they don't make Band-Aids for feelings, but you know, there's obviously racist out there, and some of the fans that attack Cam Newton, they're just flat out racist. But as far as arrogance and stuff, that gets hated on regardless of nationality. And you can look at that from Johnny Manziel. Some people like Johnny Manziel. A lot of people hate Johnny Manziel with cockiness, but
unless you're Conor McGregor, to Mayweather.
Yeah, well, I mean, people hate Conor McGregor too. I mean, if he has his fame there, but I mean, he goes out there at the Jesus comments, like gods respect gods and stuff, or whatever. I don't remember the exact quote, but to try to say that you're a god and stuff in public, I think Conor McGregor is starting to lose his marbles. Maybe a little too many hits to the head. Needs
maybe
some
he
help
thinks
with
he's
the
a rapper
PR.
Because rappers say that a lot. So.
That's true too, but yeah, he's got a lot of undeserved hate. I mean, how do you hate on somebody that gives the ball to the kid? I mean, the excessive celebration stuff. I remember Deion Sanders back in the 90s when he was dancing in the end zone, and a lot of people criticized that just because it's like, you know, a lot of the coaches and stuff say you're supposed to pretend like, you know, You're there all the time, like it's no big deal, and the dancing.
It's not.
I'm not against
though.
It.
No, that's what I'm saying. Like, I don't understand. I mean, he goes into the end zone, he scores a touchdown, and he dabs. Like, that's not excessive. Like, he's not like Deion was doing a whole dance routine. I mean, you know, Ray Lewis had all of this. Like, that's not excessive. Like, you just go in the end zone and you dab.
No, I think there was I don't remember what the letter was written about, but there was one celebration that carried on for a little too long. Someone was saying, I don't remember exactly.
The girl, the woman in Tennessee, that was because of the dab. And because it's the quarterback position, but I mean, we spoke about this, you know, last year when it happened. And for me, it's just like, listen. If you run that ball into the end zone like a running back or a receiver, then you know what? You deserve to be able to get a little celebration dance in there. I don't care, because you got 300-pound linebackers chasing after you, hitting you. You got safeties hitting you. You know, you got a Ed Reed kind of safety coming at you, one of those hard hitters. If you get past all of that and you get in the end zone on a run as a quarterback, you better go in there and dab or do the stanky leg or hit the quan or something, you know? That's for you, Cliff, right there. You got a dab or something up in there. You know, so, like, I don't know what to tell you, man. And that's why, all the hate is what's making me actually just want Cam to win the Super Bowl. But like I said, in my gut, something is telling me that the Broncos might just take this thing. But if I get to see him dab in the Super Bowl, I'm all for it, man. That's for Cam right there. Let's get it, man. I'm ready.
I was a fan of Deion Sanders doing the thing. It just adds more entertainment.
Everybody was, man. Yeah. Listen, everybody was a fan of Deion. Like, oh, that's the fun of the game. You know, that's when you were a kid.
It
that's
adds not... an extra, excitement level to it. Like, you know,
because who got the newest move? You know,
there's always something new. The Falcons had the Dirty Bird, and then
exactly
you have the grenade thing with the
whenever everybody falls out. Now, the when it's excessive, was it T.O.? That had the cell phone in the back of the goalpost, and he took it out. Like, that's excessive. But if it's just, in the moment, you get your little touchdown dance on, man, listen, whatever it is, you got to enjoy that moment. Like I said, man, you talking about some of the hardest hitters coming after you, and 9 out of 10 times you're going to still get popped anyway. You deserve to get that celebration on once you get in the end zone. That's from when you were a kid playing in the schoolyard. And that's all sports across the board. You know, you get a three-pointer shot to win the game. You get a dunk. You catch a long football touchdown or whatever in football, baseball. You hit a home run.
Especially soccer. I mean, soccer. Look at the celebrations in soccer. Exactly. Those are all. You
get in that end zone. If it was that easy to score, there'd be more professional athletes. It's not easy to do what they do. So if you get in there, go for it. Do what you got to do. I'm all for that.
Number four, but official prediction: you're picking the Broncos. You have a feeling.
I'm pulling for the Panthers, but something is just telling me that the Broncos might take it. That's just my gut. It's something telling me that the Broncos might take this one.
My prediction from the beginning of the playoffs is completely wrong.
It's all good.
I picked Patriots Cardinals from the beginning of the playoffs. They made it to the conference championships.
Blame Bill Belichick for that overtime debacle when he didn't let Tom Brady take the ball out and that whole coin toss issue. Because had they won that coin toss, Tom Brady was hot, tied the game up, they would have came back. I believe they would have won that game. That would have sealed home field advantage throughout the playoffs. So blame Belichick for that one.
That
man.
Too. And during the actual game itself, the missed extra point changed. It would have been a tie game.
I mean, even still, like this, like the game, I mean, extra point. And this is one of the most accurate kickers in football. Yeah. With Gostkowski. Gostkowski. So for him to miss an extra point, it's just like, oh, my goodness. But Tom Brady still comes back down the field, you know, they don't get the 2-point conversion, but, you know, it is what it is.
I'm not exactly wearing Broncos colors, I'm wearing Knicks colors, but they happen to be the same. I'd like to see Peyton Manning go out on top. That's the only reason why I'm picking them. If they would have played Arizona, Larry Fitzgerald has never won, so I would have liked to see him.
Yeah.
And I know Cam Newton is going to be making a lot more trips to the Super Bowl. I know Stephen A. Smith said this exact thing, that people are going to hate on Cam Newton. This is not hating on Cam Newton. This is, I want to see Peyton Manning go out on top. I want to see him win again.
And everybody gets that, though. Everybody, everybody's going to have their chance where everybody's, oh, I don't want him to win. I want to go for him. You know, everybody gets that at some point. When you're the best in whatever sports you're in, everybody gets that at some point
or
another.
If Cam Newton was playing the Patriots, no question about it, I'm pulling for the Panthers all day. Or pretty much anyone else in the AFC, I would be rooting for him. Just Peyton Manning, I want to see him go out on top. That's all it really comes down to. And he's a great athlete. He's a great guy in general. Funny in the commercials and everything. So
if Cam Newton does win, that will make him just the third African American quarterback to start and win a Super Bowl. You mentioned Doug Williams, and then of course Russell Wilson did it a couple of years ago.
And this is the fourth Super Bowl in a row featuring a black quarterback, because we had Colin Kaepernick, then Russell Wilson twice, and now Cam Newton. So
gotta see how it goes.
But
Get your wings ready. Get the blue cheese. Get the chips. Get the dip. Get the beers if you're gonna have a beer too out there. But it's going down February 6th. So you might want to be. Oh, excuse me, February 7th. So you might want to be in the building, sitting down and getting ready to watch that, because it's gonna be a crazy game. Either way, whoever you're rooting for, it's going to be a great game, and I'm definitely looking forward to it.
Even if there's a snowstorm, you go.
Oh, it's going down. No matter what, the snow. Yeah. Hey, listen, they had the Super Bowl in MetLife Stadium.
You know, going two Super Bowl parties and everything. Just make sure you're somewhere, watching the game. But the Bowling for Peace was delayed due to snow. I'm here with my Bowling for Peace T-shirt. helping promote. This was from last year when it was in New York City. Mm-hmm. Interviewed Jim Jones. A lot of great interviews that day, and there's going to be a lot more coming up February 6th, the day before the Super Bowl. Mm-hmm. So make sure you check that out in York College, Bowling for Peace, and we'll definitely keep you posted on social media.
If you haven't got them tickets, make sure y'all holler at H2O on Instagram, H2O5. Get them tickets. He had them on sale, too, because of the snow. He had the snow sale tickets, so y'all missed the sale, but he still got a couple tickets left. So hit him up if y'all need those tickets. It's definitely going down February 6th, York College in Queens. Bowling for Peace. I like the shirt though, Stabman. I like how you repping right now too, yeah, man. I mean, the shirt is hot, so you know when the shirt is hot, you gotta rock it.
Definitely. You know, got the Knicks hat to match and everything. But I got something for you too. I got a little delayed Christmas gift for you. It's a nice Knicks hat. This is for you to keep.
I mean, it matches. It does match with my shirt.
And it's not a fitted. So you.
But I'll say this is that I don't, you know, We're team apparel of teams that represent the mecca of basketball and haven't won a championship in over 40 years.
But they're the best franchise in history.
Financially.
Financially. You can't put fine print on that.
Just financially, you know?
So you're not gonna wear my Christmas gift?
I'm not wearing it, especially because right now I'm repping for the pregame right now, too. So, and we got Ladybug coming
out. I can't give it to you. I'm going to keep it for myself.
You know, Ladybug's about to join us, so I got to rep for the home team today, you know? So it is what it is. But we got a couple of other things that we got to get to, and we're going to bring Ladybug out because I know everybody's like, where's Ladybug? Why is she not on the set just yet? So I know the fans are hitting me on Twitter right now. So, and if you aren't following us on Twitter, it's @RealFanTalk. Same thing on Instagram, @RealFanTalk. Facebook is facebook.com/RealFansRealTalk. And the YouTube channel is youtube.com/ForTheFansProductions. Or you can just check us out on the website, RealFansRealTalk.com. Yep, it's in the theme song.
There you go. It's courtesy of Bobby Stone at Bobby Stone Music. Mm-hmm. In a recent video with fellow friend Scythe Man. So make sure you check that out. Can't say the name of the title, but it's a nice video.
Plus, Bobby Stone is working right now. He's in Respect Life, the web series with Boom Peace. So shout out to Bobby Stone. He out there working, man.
Yep. We'll have more information on Bowling for Peace on our social media, so make sure you follow us on that. And we had a recent interview that you want to tell us about.
Oh yeah, I was out. You know, sometimes I'll be moving and shaking. I found myself at the Format 2, which is a Black Ice event. If you guys follow battle rap, you know, we definitely doing the show. That's why we always have Cortez, you know, up here on the show. We had Chambers, who's not really a battle rapper, but he's always in the mix in every URL battle. So I got a chance to chop it up with Black Ice, who is the head of Black Ice, and Charlie Clips. So, who will also be on this season of Wildin' Out. So y'all might want to tune. I know y'all already watching Wildin' Out, but Charlie Clips is going to be the newest member of Wildin' Out. So you're going to be seeing a lot more of Charlie Clips if you don't know who he is, which you probably should. I don't know why you wouldn't, because he's over 10 million views with all of his battles combined on YouTube. So you might. You most likely already know him, but we're going to jump into that. And when we come back, we got a whole lot of celebrity sports gossip to get into because Ladybug is in the building and she is ready. She's over there merely rocking on any block right now, too. I wish we could put the cameras on her right now so y'all could see her over there merely rocking behind the scenes. Okay. This is how Ladybug does, though. You know, she just comes in. She's the life of the party, so she's ready to hype things up. So we're going to jump into that.
We'll be back with more sports talk, more gossip, and more about the Knicks, who are the best franchise in NBA history.
A whole lot is going to... Let's just get to the video.
On the building. You already know what it is, man. Real fans, real talk. You understand what I'm saying? I deal with real fans. Real talk, early.
What's going on this trip, young real fans, real talk. And I'm with Black Ice right now. We at the Cartel event in Brooklyn, right where we film Real Fans, Real Talk. It's a pleasure having you on the show. We wanted to get you live in the studio, but we know you're a busy woman. But welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me. I really appreciate it.
Now, what's the difference when you're putting on a show on the road as opposed to at home?
It really ain't no difference. because when we do our events at home, it's love. Everything be cool. It'll be a great event. This is our first time going on the road. We decided to come to New York. So this is our first experience, and I loved it. I loved it.
Definitely. Well, it was definitely a great event. I know the DNA and Danger Zone battle didn't get to go down tonight. You guys said you have plans for tomorrow?
Yeah, we got plans. We're trying to find a location. So if we get the location, we're going to
post it. What's up, y'all? It's your girl, Ladybug. I'm here again this week. Real Fans, Real Talk.
Obviously, I want to be able to get the fans what we told them we was going to give them. Unfortunately, he had a death in his family. And my condolences go out to you, DNA. But he said he'll be ready in the morning. So we're going to get it done.
And you've been on the stage all night. Who had the performance of the night for you?
The performance of the night. That's hard. That's hard. That's hard. I can't even just pick one. I like the Chilla Jones and the QB. I was excited for the K-Shine and QB. You know what I'm saying? And I enjoyed the Charlie Eclipse and Danny Myers. I like all the battles. I like all of them. I can't pick one. I'm sorry.
Yeah, it was a great night all together. So when can we look forward to seeing you back in New York?
When y'all want me here. I want to plan to make another one out here because I really like the support that I got. I like how New York took, you know what I'm saying, took to it or whatever. So we'll definitely be back.
Now, because I know everybody's tired, so I'm going to let you go in a second. But when you come back to New York, I want you to tell the fans if you're going to make sure you get on the live show with us on Thursday night.
Yes, I will. I'm going to let you know before I come so I can come and we can have everything arranged.
You heard it here first, Real Fans, Real Talk, Black Ice, The Cartel. It was a great night. Thank you for having us. Appreciate you. What's going on, Trip Young, Real Fans, Real Talk? I'm here with the man, the myth, the legend, Charlie Clips. I can't curse because this is going on TV. We don't want to get kicked off the air. But Charlie Clips, once again, I'm going to say performance of the night, but I don't know if I'm being biased or not.
Because we looking like that, you know what I mean? It might think you biased because we looking like you just shaved. You know what I mean? I got the beard.
Exactly. But how because I know you got a lot of battles last year. You starting off the year early. How do you stay motivated to come up with new bars?
The fans keep me motivated, man. In battle rap, the love I receive is tremendous. And the hate I receive is tremendous. So all the complaints about me and this, that, and the third, you know, when you top dog or people call you the GOAT, you're gonna take a lot of hits, internet wise, comment wise. So I don't really read as much as I used to, but everybody reports back to me on what a lot of people were saying. So I just take all that in, man, and it keeps me going hard. Because whether you're talking about me negative or talking about me positive, you're talking about me. I gotta keep that going, you know? So I want to say to fans, and I just want to say I'm self-motivated, too. You know what I mean? When it's time to rock and roll, it's time to rock and roll. So, and then, big man upstairs, man, he definitely, you know, is one of the reasons I stay motivated. So just
If you're not the GOAT right now, who's left for you to beat in order for you to be the GOAT?
I let the people decide if I'm the GOAT. Truth be told, it's probably like two battles left for me. My new thing is I don't even be mentioning these dudes. They're already good in terms of limelight, but I don't want to give them any more, man. They know who they are, man. They get it, you know what I'm saying? I probably got like two big battles left, and we just have to take it from there, you know what I'm saying?
Can you tell us who's next? We gotta wait.
I got a one rounder on UW, that's Arsenal and Ray Swag League, with a dude by the name of Authentic. That's the artist they working with. He's nice. They bringing him up. And you step in the ring, you gotta go to the champ. So they want him to do a one round, you know, they don't want me rough him up too bad. So they said, nah, just one round, don't beat him up too bad. So I got that. It's a 2-on-2 thing about to go down, that's gonna be crazy. And then the real big battles probably won't take place to probably like May, June, Nome 6 or whatnot, you know what I'm saying? Maybe a Cal. I'm not, you know what? You know what? Pardon my French, excuse me.
We're gonna get us kicked off the air.
Pardon my French, you know. Maybe Calico, you know what I'm saying? That's my homie. That's like one of the big names I feel like, is left. And there's one more of a dude that's out there, you know what I'm saying? You could find him chilling next to T-Rex or, you know, hanging out with Tay Rock probably, or, you know, I don't want to say homie name. He always speak on me, man. I don't like speaking on him. Let him talk. I ain't going to talk. But that's the two. big battles I got left. Other than that, though, you know, I like giving dudes shots, as you've seen tonight. Danny Myers is actually climbing the ranks, so, you know, I wouldn't really say that's a shot, but we went at it tonight, but you know the results, so, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I'm going to have to go with Clips. I had it 2-1, but when I watch it again, it might go to 3-0.
Yeah, that first round was crazy. I know everybody was saying I pretty much won the second and third straight, you know, because he started, you know, deteriorating down the end. His rounds, his bars was not there like they was in the beginning. But, you know, my thing is, that's the dope part about it, is when you watch it live, you don't really remember everything per se, so you got to go back and watch it again. And it's going to be dope, you know, so.
It's a long night. Clips, I'm going to let you get out of here. Been a fan since the first time Grandma's Good Cooking came out. So appreciate you coming on the show.
Hey, I appreciate y'all, man. We're going to get some more work done. This ain't going to be the only interview I do with y'all, man. It's all love. So you already know what it is, man. Charlie Clips.
All right, we are back live here on Real Fans, Real Talk. Mark the Statman Skevich alongside Trip Young. And yes, you could calm down on social media. Ladybug is here.
Welcome back,
Ladybug.
I'm here. You see, I had to rush. I don't got makeup on. This is crazy. This is like, ladies is going to come at me. They're going to be like, come on, Ladybug. You're supposed to represent. You're supposed to have the beat face. I'll show y'all.
And we're in HD, so everybody, you know, I don't notice it, though.
You look good. Thank you.
You said you're all good.
Thank you. But what's going on, guys? How's everything?
It's good. It's Super Bowl time.
I know. Mm-hmm. I know. I'm actually working that day, but I will be watching it, so I'm excited for it. And definitely, I'm just going to start off with this rumor mill, because guess how much it costs to play a 30-second commercial for the Super Bowl? Just take a random guess.
It's probably more than we have in the budget.
Way more.
I'm going to say that right now.
Because... I don't know who's going to be sponsoring that.
It's always several million. I guess.
Last I checked, it was at like three.
3 million.
Okay. Yeah, I think last time I checked, it was at three.
This year, to play a 30-second commercial for the Super Bowl will be $4.5 million.
So the Real Fans Real Talk commercial probably is not going to be played during the Super Bowl, but we try to get it after the Super Bowl.
We'll post it on YouTube.
Yeah, we're just going to post it straight up to we ain't worried about it. We're going to post it online anyway. We're gonna make some cutbacks. We'd have to get rid of the whole staff in order to put that commercial up. So
it increased 75% between 2005 and 2014. And it's because last year alone, there were 114.4 million people watching the Super Bowl. So, you know, put that into number. You know, my mathematicians crunch those numbers. They're definitely putting that price tag at $5 million.
That is crazy.
So I want to see whose commercial is going to play on the Super Bowl, because they got money. So I mean, I'm going to be emailing whoever's commercial is up there.
I mean, it's always the big players out there. Yeah. You got... You know, Doritos commercial you're going to see. You're going to see
cars,
a Pepsi commercial.
You know, you see a, you know,
They can afford those
that was wasn't it the Kia commercial? That was the big thing? The Kia Soul?
Kia's been up there. But they getting a lot of money. They got the NBA, too, so the Kia's getting the money now.
With Blake Griffin punching people out.
But who's buying Kia's that they got this kind of money? You know, I don't see Kia's on the road.
Yeah, I don't know. They got money. That's why I need an email. I need to do something.
Yeah.
We got to hit them up. We can do the mouse. We can do the mouse rendition. We can get a choreography going on. We can do it. Because
they got it over at Kia. We need that check, man. We're going to have them sponsor the show from now on. I'll drive a Kia. And they're going to send a check over.
Nope. But definitely talking about Blake Griffin. I don't know, boo. Come on, get it together. But definitely, you know, we all know that, you know, he hurt his hand from fighting, for punching the assistant equipment manager. And now they're saying that he was drunk. They said a few hours prior, he was seen at this bar having a round of drinks before he even got to the restaurant and where the altercation happened. So now they're saying he was just, you know, drunk and just swinging the hands crazy. And now he's out 4 to 6 weeks for the broken hand. And it's just, he was already out already. So now it's just a big nasty mess. But now the fact that they're trying to throw... the whole drinking thing into it. It's like, come on, now you're careless. You just, you know, you can't handle your alcohol. They're just making it look really messy. So, you know, it's unfortunate.
Well,
know?
A lot of people have issues handling their alcohol, but...
But taking it there?
Yeah, I mean, at least if you would have punched a trainer on the other team, then I could understand that you don't punch a trainer on your own team.
Exactly.
And their friends.
And so. That's what he said. He really made a public apology. He said, you know what, this was something that shouldn't even came out to social media. You know, when close friends have issues and they have problems, and the fact that they're both in that public light, it's very hard to really even, like, weed it out. So it was, he apologized to, you know, the franchise and everything. And he said, you know what, this was something that should have stayed just amongst friends. It shouldn't even got out there like that. But, you know, the fact that it is, it definitely shows the downside to being famous and just having, you know, altercations with your friends. Like, you wouldn't want to get into an altercation and have it be publicized. And
well, one,
I mean, you gotta have discipline, especially with your friends. Like, I mean, yeah. I never punched Trip Young in
the face. Yeah, well, we don't do that kind of thing. We know how to handle stupid things. Like,
not only that,
he just literally just now rejected my Christmas gift on live television.
You could have just won two.
But you're not drinking right now, so it's different. You're not drinking.
But I don't punch you when I'm drinking either.
Listen, at the end of the day, he got to control himself. Like, I don't know, man. If you can't handle your liquor, because now not only, you know, you already was injured.
Yes.
And hurting your team because, you know, you're one of the best players in the league. Mm-hmm. But now for something stupid, now you out another month and a half. Now, fortunately.
That was his shooting hand. Yeah. That was his shooting
fortunately,
hand.
The Clippers are actually playing, you know, pretty better. Good with that. Yeah, they might even be playing better that since
they're
he's been out
12
on
and
injury.
3 and,
yeah. So, you know, but at the end of the day, you still want to have Blake Griffin out there on the court.
You want him
available. That was a discussion that they were having, that Chris Paul is playing a lot better without Blake Griffin, and the team as a whole is playing without Blake Griffin better without Blake Griffin, because it's kind of like, you know, Carmelo Anthony and previous years where, you know, you give him the ball and then you kind of slow things down.
Yeah.
He gets the ball more than any other player, and then he's doing like an isolation thing. He's going to the hole or he's shooting it. So it's more of a team game, and Chris Paul is playing significantly better without him. So there's talks about whether or not the Clippers should trade him, not just for the incident, but they're kind of realizing, hey, you know, we kind of play better without you, and you could, you know, you're definitely a high trade value.
Yeah.
You know, to teams where you could get several pieces or another superstar player.
What do you think about a trade sending Blake Griffin to Cleveland for Kevin Love?
That was actually discussed as well. You know, Kevin Love, when this discussion was out before, Kevin Love was the better player than Blake Griffin.
Yeah.
But last season, Blake Griffin really came out and showed how talented he is. So I think he's, getting better while Kevin Love is getting worse. You know, Kevin Love's stock is going down mainly because he's on Cleveland with two other superstars.
Yeah.
So, and the other thing is Kevin Love is more of a defensive liability than Blake Griffin.
Yeah.
So I don't think that would be a good trade for the Clippers. So.
And they just traded Josh Smith back to the Rockets as well. So. It might be in the midst of some making some more moves.
That was one of the first things that would come to mind. And the general manager Griffin, has the same last name in Cleveland, said that he wasn't going to. Kevin Love is not on the trading block. But
you know,
I mean, you throw Blake Griffin's name out there, he might reconsider.
Exactly.
It, so.
So yeah. So definitely talking about. Considering things. As we know, Kurt Angle, he's definitely been in the wrestling world, the well-known name in WWE wrestling. He definitely wanted, he's considering fighting in MMA.
Okay.
Now, you know, he had his little dabble here and there. He hasn't really been, you know, contracted, really. He's just been back and forth. But at 47 years old, he's considering.
I didn't realize he was that old. That's crazy.
Yeah. Seven gold medals. You know, I grew up with Kurt Angle, you know, back then.
Won a gold medal with a broken freaking neck.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, I was that wrestling girl in front of the TV, glued to the TV. But, you know, he was dropping names like, okay, you know, I want to, you know, get to fight these people. And he threw out Kimbo Slice.
Well.
And not only Kimbo Slice, Ken Shamrock, Dan Severn, you know.
These are all WWE guys. He's throwing out that fight. Well,
yeah, but,
Shamrock
kind of
came from that, you know, MMA style anyway. But I see Kimbo Slice in MMA UFC when he was fighting, he's not that good. Now, if it was in the backyard in Miami, Kimbo Slice, I'm all for Kimbo Slice. But again, I didn't realize that Shamrock was that old. I didn't realize he was Kurt 47. Angle. I mean, sorry, excuse me. Kurt Angle was 47 years old. That's kind of old to just be starting.
But he did admit that he's not trying to jump in and fight someone who's in their prime.
Yeah.
But it's like, all right, you're already going in at 47. Yeah.
Well, I don't understand. Why is he trying to do this at his age?
Because he already got the medals around his neck. He needs something new. The medals.
He's bored. And when you're bored, like, you should not make decisions to fight in MMA. Because bored at 47, you know, I don't know, man. God bless him.
I mean, Herschel Walker.
Well, yeah.
Over there, older than that, put him past 50. So.
Yeah. I mean,
it's not like Angle's not in good shape. I mean, he, you know.
But we're talking about MMA, though. This ain't WWE.
But, I mean, he comes from a legit wrestling background, gold medal.
But that was...
A lot of MMA... When UFC started, but it's not like he doesn't still train.
He's been doing angle plexes.
Yeah, but look at Brock Lesnar, too. I mean, he's a lot younger, too, but yeah, I mean...
A lot younger. Huge difference, though, man. I don't know.
He's a lot shorter, too, Kurt Angle.
I mean, listen, I wish him well. I don't want him to get hurt in the ring.
I mean, he throws Ken Shamrock. They have the same finishing move, that ankle lock. The ankle lock, and Ken Shamrock used to use that ankle lock in MMA fights back in the day.
If it's Ken Shamrock, though, I'm just going to feel like it's a WWE match. So I don't even know it, like... Is Vince the man behind this?
I mean, he's throwing some challenges out there.
But Dan Severn was also in WWE. So, yeah. I don't know, man. I feel like Vince is behind this whole thing.
He's always behind something.
Vince McMahon is probably in better shape than Ken Shamrock, Kurt Angle, and Kimbo Slice at 70. I don't know if he's juicing or not. I don't want to put that out there. Vince McMahon is brolic at 70, so he might want to actually get in the ring and see what he has. Exactly.
But definitely calling out people, definitely, you know. I don't know why. Mayweather always appears somewhere. You know, Chip Young is all for the money team. But,
that's right. I'm going to just get me a money team hat. And so.
Oh, man. No, we're going to keep that hat you got right now because I'm liking this pregame hat. Thank you so much. But Amir Khan definitely sat and was talking to reporters, and he was ready to call out Mayweather. And he's like, you know what? He's been ducking me. You know, I'm ready. What I got to do, he's a coward. He's being a punk. He needs to come out of retirement. He's basically provoking Mayweather. And he's hoping to fight Danny Garcia just so he can put that, you know, that battery in Mayweather's back to come out of retirement and fight him. So that's definitely the proposal he's putting up now. On the list of people with Mayweather versus the world, you know, I got to throw it out there, but that's another one on the list now.
Okay, first of all, you know, I gotta say this, I'm down with the money team. That's one. Two, Amir Khan has been calling out Mayweather for the longest. I'm tired of him calling out Mayweather. You're not on Mayweather's level, all right?
And he had the fight like a year back too, but
yeah, and he couldn't do it because of Ramadan, which I mean. I support your religious beliefs, but at the same time,
it's not like it fell in Ramadan in September. It was just a matter of like your fasting.
He was fasting and stuff. so he didn't want to do it. So you blew your opportunity, you know. And don't come now. I mean, obviously, if you didn't notice, the belt that was being fought for between Danny Garcia and Robert Guerrero. Danny Garcia and Robert Guerrero was Floyd Mayweather's WBC welterweight championship belt. He's retired. Let it go. It's over for that dream, bro. Like, come on, let that man go. Like, you weren't gonna beat Mayweather, okay? You couldn't even beat Danny Garcia or Pacquiao or Marquez. Ooh, or any of those other guys, bro. Like, you got to just let it go, man. It's over.
He realizes he made a big mistake missing out on that check. Like,
you had
it's not like you were fighting on a religious holiday or something like that. You're talking about how you're probably not going to beat him because of fasting and stuff like that. You weren't going to beat him either way.
Exactly.
You should have just taken that big check and you would have been good. But that's the decision you made. You're going to have to live with that for the rest of your life.
Exactly.
That's the end of it.
And because if he does,
plus Mayweather's fighting Conor McGregor.
Exactly, in his next fight. Either him or
they're the same. They're about the same weight class and everything, so they could probably fight in a boxing match.
Exactly.
And Conor McGregor will do it just for the paycheck.
Yeah, because he's still going to get a lovely paycheck. So. But I mean, just
and Vince McMahon will be the referee.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh,
Vince,
no.
Vince is a special guest referee.
I can't. Super promotions. Great. Crazy.
I mean, listen, Mayweather was on WWE before at WrestleMania, made $20 million to appear on WrestleMania and then to come out the next day on Raw. So, you know, he I'm sure he wouldn't mind working with Vince again, getting another one of them big checks like that.
Nope. Maybe he'll fight Kurt Angle. He's looking at exciting
hey,
things.
You see, it could work out like
exactly.
That.
Exactly. What are you going to do, man? You got to give it up. Amir Khan, just stop. Just try somebody else. Fight Brona or somebody, you know, maybe.
But, yeah, so that's definitely my rundown for the week. Make sure you guys always stay tuned because I keep it updated.
That's right. Mm-hmm. We love when you come out, Lady Boy. I do want to jump back into that fight, though, really quick this past Saturday night. I mentioned Danny Garcia. Congratulations. He did take that vacant WBC welterweight belt. I'm a little tight because I actually wanted to see Danny Garcia fight Floyd Mayweather. But, I mean, obviously, I doubt that's going to happen at this point.
Well, he gives the belt and then he takes it back.
Well, I mean,
and then retires again.
and does it again after he breaks the record.
That was probably it. Yeah, he'll fight whoever won that fight in May. And that's how he would probably disorder it. He's fighting in May. Like.
Yeah, so he got the... But shout out to Danny Garcia. Got the decision over Robert Guerrero. It was a great fight, though, actually. They were going back and forth throughout the entire fight. So I was actually happy with the end results of that fight. It was a good look for boxing, you know. And really quick, Statman, you got the shirt on. Just in case you guys missed it earlier, Bowling for Peace has been rescheduled for February 6th. It's still going to go down at York College in Queens. Real Fans, Real Talk is there. We are the official media for Bowling for Peace. As y'all heard it from Haran himself. Mm-hmm. So we're going to be in the building. If you haven't got your tickets, holla at H2O on Instagram, H2O5, and get them tickets and see us there. Statman.
All right, that's about it. That wraps it up for this edition of Real Fans, Real Talk. Thanks to Ladybug for coming on. Make sure you check out the pregame tomorrow night at 8 p.m. Trip Young.
Hold on, cause Cliff is back in the booth right now, signaling for me to dab one more time. So
he's gonna have a meme now. Trip Young's gonna have a meme tonight on Instagram for dabbing.
That's for you,
it's
Cliff.
Over.
Just for you.
Dabbing for the Knicks.
He dabbed with the pregame hat too. See, we're gonna have to put him on the pregame tomorrow with the dab.
I'm in the building.
Thanks again for joining us, and once again, rest in peace, Richie Meyer. Thank you, to his friends and family out there. Great man. I definitely appreciate him. Rest in peace, and good night, everyone. Check us out next time on Real Fans, Real Talk.
Rest in peace.
Face facts, what up? Real Fans, Real Talk.com. Where Arthur Domus, Trip Young, and intern Tom. For the white and black fans, Asia to Manhattan. I get all my facts from my bro, Mark the Stats Man. If you're not tuned in, I recommend a CAT scan. And if your brain checks out, then you deserve a backhand. Sports, gossip, all the hot topics. Real Fans, Real Talk.com got it. They got the hottest bloggers.
Did Jeremy Lin hurt?
Well, log onto the site and you can hear it from them first. I'm talking about the latest. I'm talking about the greatest. Go check out the archives. Even tell a neighbor. Tell them Bobby sent ya from spring to winter. Tuning in should be the only thing on your